Thanks for being here, everybody, on a lovely Friday, almost afternoon. Oh, it is afternoon. So I'd like to welcome you all to the Timothy Johnson Medical Scholars Seminar Series. For those of you who are not aware, this series, this program is named in honor of Dr. Timothy Johnson, obviously. And Dr. Johnson was one of the founding faculty and leaders of the Virginia Tech Carilion School of Medicine, who was very much involved with the original development of the curriculum here, and also very enthusiastic about the sort of program that we have here now to engage medical students with leading scholars from around the country, in addition to those that are here, but bringing people in to give you these opportunities. So we named this program in his honor. Dr. Johnson tragically died several years in after the medical school opened. So we like to remember him by acknowledging the great work he did and the contributions to this fantastic medical school. Just to remind you, there'll be another seven or so of these throughout the year, same time and station, related to the curriculum blocks that are going on, of course. And in every case, starting today for this year, you'll see that the people that are brought in are truly leading physician scientists who are involved with both the practice of medicine and the advancement of the field through their groundbreaking research. And today will be a great start to that. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce Kenny Young. I started to say Dr. Kenny Young, but I'm getting a little bit ahead of you there, Kenny, but introduce Kenny Young, who knows our speaker today, and we'll introduce him for today's seminar. Kenny, come on up and take the podium, please. Thanks.
Good afternoon, everyone. So, Dr. Brooks graduated summa cum laude with a degree in zoology from the University of Maryland. He was supported with during his MD PhD training at the University of Pennsylvania through the Medical Scientists and Training Program, where he did his thesis work with Dr. Kenneth Fishbeck, who is now also at the NIH in the neurogenetics branch of the National Institute of Neurological Diseases Disorders and Stroke. Wow. He looked at expanded glutamine repeats in the androgen receptor. And Dr. Brooks then moved to University of Michigan, where he did a residency in ophthalmology and completed a fellowship in pediatric ophthalmology. So Dr. Brooks next traveled back to Maryland, this time to the NIH, and he completed a fellowship in medical genetics at the National Human Genome Research Institute. He has remained at the NIH in the National Eye Institute of the NEI, where in addition to an active research career, he has been an integral part of training as the director of the Ophthalmic Genetics Fellowship Training Program. Until just a few months ago, he was also served as the clinical director of the NEI, overseeing clinical research and patient care programs at the National Eye Institute. He currently serves as the branch chief of ophthalmic genetics in the visual functioning branch. So Dr. Brooks served as the first director of the National Ophthalmic Genotyping Network. But I think that's iGene, isn't it? That's the iGene, right? Yeah. And launched the ophthalmology genetics clinic at the Children's National Medical Center. He's also a senior ophthalmology consultant in the NIH Undiagnosed Diseases Program and is a board certified in both ophthalmology and medical genetics. He's published numerous papers and articles and book chapters on the genetics of eye disease and has received numerous awards, including the Presidential Early Career Award for Science and Engineering, the nation's highest honor for young investigators, and six National Directors Awards, the most recent being in 2021. So the goal of Dr. Brooks's research is to understand the causes and mechanisms of inherited eye diseases, especially those that affected children, and to use that knowledge to develop prevention strategies and treatments. Years ago, Dr. Brooks briefly introduced my work to the Board of Scientific Directors, so this is particularly a momentous occasion for me as I get to introduce him to all of you for the Timothy Johnson Medical Lecture Scholarship Series. And as a former student, I can attest that he's a brilliant and compassionate mentor. Please join me in giving Dr. Brian Brooks a warm, hokey welcome as he discusses potential treatment strategies for albinism.
So thank you very much for the kind introduction, Kenny, and thanks to Dr. LeConte, Dr. Friedlander, and company for inviting me to be part of this lecture series. It's really a pleasure to be here to see some old friends and to meet some new ones. So in the next 45 minutes or so, I'd like to talk to you about a disease that I have been particularly interested in over the past 20 years, namely oculocutaneous albinism. and to talk about a little bit of our work to try to understand its pathogenesis, but also to hopefully find potential treatments for this condition. So what we'll start with is just some overview and background. We will go through what I consider to be kind of the central hypothesis of this work. We'll then kind of break the meat of the talk into two major components. One will be exploring potential small molecules, drugs that might be useful for albinism. And I forgot to turn this on. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay, great. If folks can hear me, just raise your hand or something in the background. You're good? Okay. And then the last part of the talk, we'll discuss identification of potentially some novel factors for using retinal pigment epithelium that is derived from human-induced pluripotent stem cells, or iPS cells. Turn that on. Okay, that's probably a little bit better. There we go. So oculocutaneous albinism, or OCA, is an autosomal recessive condition that's associated with reduced melanin pigmentation in the hair, the skin, and the eyes. Recall that melanin is a complex biomolecule that is packaged into subcellular organelles called melanosomes. The synthesis begins humbly enough with the amino acid tyrosine, which undergoes two hydroxylation steps. This is the first and rate limiting step in melanin production via the enzyme tyrosinase. Tyrosine goes to L-DOPA, goes to dopaquinone. And Kenny, when he was at the NEI, worked further down in this tree here on the protein, tyrosine related protein 1. So just so that we are all on the same page, recall that within the eye, which will be the focus of this talk, there are a couple of pigmented layers. So there is the retinal pigment epithelium, which abuts the photoreceptors, the light sensing cells within the neural retina. These are derived from neuroectoderm. The blood supply of the outer retina is given by the choroid, and mixed in with those blood vessels are melanocytes, similar to your skin melanocytes, that are derived from neural crest. Now, the melanosomes that are in the retinal pigment epithelium are similar to, but not identical with with the melanocytes in the choroid. For the purpose of this talk, it's also important to know that melanosomes undergo a series of maturation steps where they start off with little to no melanin. They have the structural protein called pmel that looks like with these striations, and then they become progressively pigmented. So for the sake of this talk, things that haven't formed pigment yet are going to be called premelanosomes, stage 1 and 2 melanosomes. And those that have started to pigment or have completed their pigmentation will be called mature melanosomes. So albinism is genetically heterogeneous. For the purpose of this talk, we're going to focus our attention on the two most common forms of albinism in North America, namely OCA1 and OCA2. So OCA1 is caused by mutations in the tyrosinase gene, that first and rate limiting step in melanin production. If you have no tyrosinase activity, you're said to have OCA1A, whereas if you have a little bit of tyrosinase activity, you're said to have OCA1B. So those patients make a little bit of melanin pigment. OCA2 causes hypopigmentation via a completely different mechanism. It's a mutation in a channel called the P protein, which is a chloride channel, which sits on the melanosome membrane. This is the most common form of albinism in Black Americans and in sub-Saharan Africa. So two ways of getting albinism via two different mechanisms. There are also, as I'll just point out, other inheritance patterns of albinism, and there are both syndromic and non-syndromic forms of albinism, but we won't be talking about that today. So why am I interested in this as an ophthalmologist?
Well, the reason is because a major problem that folks with albinism have is a decrease in their best corrected visual acuity, meaning no matter what pair of glasses I give a child or an adult with albinism, I can't get them to 20/20 visual acuity. There is a variable amount of vision loss in this condition. There's roughly an inverse correlation between the amount of pigmentation and the visual acuity. So the more melanin pigmentation, the better the acuity as a general rule. The reason for the decreased visual acuity is probably multifactorial, but the major cause we think is due to lack of maturation of the fovea. Now recall that the fovea is this highly specialized area of the neural retina where the front of the eye focuses light on the neural retina, and it focuses it when it's working properly right on this fovea, right here in this highly specialized area where you see excavation of the inner retinal layers and a concentration of cone photoreceptors. This is the area that gives you your 20/20 visual acuity. Without that, your acuity drops. There are also some other interesting phenotypes. So any baby that's born with bilateral vision loss beyond a certain point will develop nystagmus. So the nystagmus is probably secondary, but may also degrade the visual acuity to some extent. There's also this very curious pathology that we won't talk about very much today, which is that there's an abnormal decussation of the ganglion cell axons at the level of the optic chiasm. So in you and me, approximately 50% of the fibers, say from my left eye, are gonna go to the ipsilateral portion of my brain, and 50% are gonna go to the contralateral part of my brain. In folks with albinism, there's a predominance of contralateral fibers that are there. There are also phenotypes that may be complicating, namely iris transillumination. I'll explain that in a second, and reduced pigmentation in the fundus. What we're looking at here, so we're looking at a picture of an iris, and you're all familiar with the red eye reflex that when you take someone's picture, what you're seeing there is actually light bouncing off the back of the retina and coming through the pupil. And in you and me, the pigment in our iris is blocking the rest of that light coming through. However, in patients with albinism that have reduced melanin content, you have all of this light shining through. It's what gives the pink-eyed appearance to folks with complete forms of albinism. Because more light's being let into the eye, we think that this contributes to things like glare sensitivity for patients with albinism, which is a major problem. So in my mind as a scientist, this raises kind of an interesting question, which is what is the biological relationship between melanin pigment production in the RPE, retinal pigment epithelium, and or choroid, and visual system development in the neural retina? So the genes that code for melanin pigment are in one cell type, and they cause a developmental effect in an adjacent cell type. So we would call in developmental biology, that would be a non-cell autonomous effect. And so the postulate is that there's something in, we're going to postulate here, the retinal pigment epithelium that's different. More about that later. Perhaps more important to me as a clinician, even if we don't understand what this biological relationship is, if we had a way of improving melanin pigmentation during visual development, could we improve vision? Could we move the needle for patients with albinism? Why might that be possible? Because this is a developmental defect after all. Well, it turns out that foveal development begins prenatally, but it continues postnatally, certainly for the first 6 months of life, but probably out to 2 years or more. So there may be a window of opportunity where you identify a baby, say in the nursery, perhaps through newborn screening, confirm your diagnosis, you exact some kind of treatment, perhaps only for a period of time. You wouldn't necessarily have to make it lifelong, and you make a positive impact in that child's life. So let's talk a little bit about exploring potential small molecules as therapies. So as we've mentioned, patients with oculocutaneous albinism 1 have defects in this rate, first and rate limiting step of melanin production. Tyrosinase as an enzyme obeys the same rules as other enzymes, which for those that are in graduate school, you know, if you want to purify an enzyme, one of the things that you can do to help stabilize the enzyme is to give it saturating doses of its substrate. So in this case, the amino acid tyrosine. So if you could raise tyrosine levels, maybe you could stabilize tyrosinase. And also, you're familiar with enzyme kinetics, maybe you can keep it closer to its maximum velocity, keep it running as fast as you can. So how might we increase tyrosine in somebody's body? So simply giving them lots of tyrosine, say, orally, probably wouldn't work because it wouldn't get absorbed. And that which is absorbed in excess would probably be rapidly excreted in via the kidney in the urine. So we have to come up with a different way. So when I was in genetics training with Dr. Doherty, I learned about a type of condition called hereditary tyrosinemia type 1, or HT1. So these babies have a defect in this last step in the degradation of tyrosine. So you can't increase tyrosine by turning the spigot on more, but maybe you can increase tyrosine by plugging the drain. In fact, these patients develop elevated levels of tyrosine in their blood. They also develop levels of toxic intermediates, namely succinyl acetone, which when untreated kills the liver, the kidney, and eventually the baby. Luckily, we have a drug to treat these kids, which has extended the lifespan considerably, namely nitisinone or NTBC, which blocks tyrosine degradation at a step that's upstream of the toxic intermediates. A side effect of this compound is to raise your plasma tyrosine. So the central hypothesis to this work was that by blocking tyrosine degradation, we're going to elevate serum tyrosine concentrations, we're going to stabilize tyrosinase, and thereby increase melanin synthesis. So we addressed this in a mouse model. So these two mice are genetically identical with one exception. They both have mutations in the tyrosinase gene. So the background strain is called BLAC6, C57 BLAC6. The mouse here that has completely white fur and pink eyes has a essentially dead tyrosinase enzyme. That's our model of OCA1A. The name of this model is C2J, so you may see it referred to as C2J. This guy, has a temperature-sensitive mutation in tyrosinase, such that there's pigment production in the more distal extremities, and they also have this off-white color to their coat. So this is a mouse model of OCA1B. The overall experimental design is pretty straightforward. We're going to take mice of a certain age, 3 to 4 months, and we're going to give them either, each genotype, either drug in levels that are kind of comparable to what you might, the maximum dose that you might treat, say, a child with, or we're going to treat them with a vehicle. It turns out that melanin pigmentation is preferentially deposited in growing hair, so we're going to pluck an area of hair on the flank and see what color it grows in. And we're also going to look at the pigmentation in the eye, both clinically and using microscopy. So this is what we found. So this is just a regular BLAC6 mouse by way of comparison. Here's our C2J mouse, which is the OCA1A model. Unfortunately, when you treat this guy with nitisinone, you do sweet nothing to its fur color. However, when you have a little bit of tyrosinase activity in the OCA1B mouse, in fact, in the treated T mouse, you see that the fur starts to grow back brown. Furthermore, when we start to look at the eyes of these mice, so this is iris transillumination, so just as we saw in the patients, here we're looking at the C2J and the iris transillumination remains complete. However, in the OCA1B mouse, we start to see after 1 month of treatment, some early pigmentation deposition around the collarette of the iris. Now, when we look ultrastructurally, we see, again, this is a retinal pigment epithelium, iris, and choroid, three pigmented layers. The C2J untreated, treated, really no difference. However, in the Himalayan mice, in all three layers, we see an increased number of these pigmented, so stage three and four melanosomes in all three of the layers. And this is the quantitation for that, showing that in the dark blue bars compared to the aqua bars. Furthermore, if we treat pregnant dams with nitisinone, the Himalayan mice, they're normally born with this like kind of beige coat color that gets shed or molted and then grows in that off-white color. But those, the pups that are born to those mothers turn out more of this milk chocolate brown, and they have a little bit of pigmentation along their collarette of the iris. So as I mentioned, the drug in question, nitisinone, is used to treat babies. It's used to treat humans. So it's FDA approved as a for a rare disease indication. And so we wanted to ask, well, if we had patients with OCA1B, could we give them nitisinone and change melanin pigmentation? So we did a pilot study of this. This was five adults, all with clinically and molecularly proven OCA1B. Again, the experimental design's pretty straightforward. We're going to establish baseline along several axes, several clinical outcome measures. And then we're going to put everybody on drug. And then we're going to follow them every 3 months and see how those things change. The dose of medication is 2 milligrams per day in every patient. To put that in perspective, so babies that are put on this drug are put 1 to 2 milligrams per kilogram per day, but they're also put on tyrosine restricted diets. These patients had normal diets. And as I mentioned, we measured our predetermined outcomes. So what would you measure? So ideally what you want to do is you want to look at vision. These are all adults, so they all have mature visual systems. So we would not anticipate that you would see an increase in best corrected visual acuity. The ultimate goal would be, of course, to treat babies with this who do have developing visual systems and where you may be able to move the needle in that regard. So the outcome variable that we chose in this case was melanin pigmentation as a kind of surrogate to see if the drug was working. Now, as you're learning about research methods, you know that one of the things that you want in any outcome variable that you are using in a clinical trial is that you want to have a robust dynamic range of whatever it is you're measuring. You want to have good inter-observer or observation reproducibility of that measure. And so we developed this grading scheme for iris transillumination along 9 points. And showed that there was excellent inter-observer correlation. So if Dr. Friedlander rated it and I rated it, we would get something pretty good. And it doesn't have to be a physician. We actually, I bought like $100 of pizza and brought a bunch of IRTA students in, and they did just as good as the physicians on this. Other things that we looked at was what was peripheral melanin like. So in the hair, or in the skin, using a technique called reflectometry. You can measure hair melanin biochemically. We, of course, will measure visual acuity. We'll also measure contrast sensitivity as kind of a surrogate for glare sensitivity. And then, of course, things related to safety. So there are blood chemistries. You can run into hepatotoxicity with this compound, and corneal toxicity. So we need to measure that. We'll also measure the electrical function of the retina using electroretinography. And because tyrosine is upstream of not only melanin, L-DOPA and melanin, but also of all of your catecholamine neurotransmitters, we did neuropsych testing just to make sure that we weren't doing anything untoward. These are the participants. The genotypes are shown here. All five individuals completed the trial. There were no serious adverse events, and the drug was very well tolerated. Kind of as expected, plasma tyrosine levels increased in all patients up to an order of magnitude, so probably well enough to stabilize the enzyme. Unfortunately, when we looked at iris transillumination, we did not see an effect. Here, this is where we used the post-baccalaureate students. They had an excellent inter-observer reliability. So that for doing this kind of thing, it also cuts down on the cost of doing the research. But the it cost me $100 in pizza, and that was about it. And but unfortunately, there was no change in the overall iris transillumination score. Kind of post hoc analysis showed us that there were probably some technical reasons which may have been limiting to us. However, when we started to look at more peripheral outcomes, we saw a hint of a signal. So when we looked at reflectometry in the skin, you can measure something, you get a number back called the M index for the melanin index. We saw an increase in hair melanin and an increase in non-sun exposed skin. We also saw a trend in the biochemistry of the hair for an increase in eumelanin synthesis and a decrease in a different kind of melanin called pheomelanin. The reaction to the drug was heterogeneous. So there were some patients, when you looked at them, didn't really seem to do very much. But there were some patients, like this gentleman, who had two baseline visits. You see his blonde hair and his blondish beard, who went on drug, said, "Doc, I've never been able to tan in my life," went out on the lake in Minnesota, tanned just fine, and my hair turned brown. And he is off the trial, but he still calls me up every once in a while and he wants to be on nitisinone. The visual acuity, the number of letters read on the eye chart actually improved a little bit. This is statistically significant, but not clinically significant. It would not be considered a relevant change physiologically. There was no meaningful change in contrast sensitivity, and it was safe by all our other measures. So that's great if you can kind of piece together a good candidate molecule to test. How might you go about trying to find other new molecules? Well, you might want to do a drug screen. To do a drug screen, however, you need large amounts of purified protein. So working with my colleagues, Monica Lilinska and Yuri Sergeyev, we were able to purify to homogeneity a form of human tyrosinase, either wild type or mutant. And we're able to show that they behave in a way that was consonant with what the published enzymology of those variants were. You can get this in milligram quantities. So we then collaborated with folks at NCATS, which is the kind of the translational institute for the NIH, and using both wild type recombinant protein, using wild type recombinant protein, we screened over 34,000 unique compounds. We found lots of inhibitors, which is kind of the opposite of what we're looking for albinism, but may have dermatologic implications for people who have hyperpigmented lesions. There were 9 potential activators, and then these were followed up using further detailed studies. So here we're showing some enzymology. We're showing L-DOPA as a concentration with and without, in this case, the one drug which bore out in all of those tests. And that drug is called amperone, or 4-amino antipyrene. This was actually used in Eastern Europe as an analgesic many years ago. So it's been used in humans, but it has been discontinued because there are basically better and cheaper alternatives, safer alternatives. In the presence of amperone, however, we're able to see an increase in the production of L-DOPA in a tyrosinase assay. And then here is just basically a dose response of amperone showing the same thing. And then if you look at a fish model of OCA1B, here are some controls at day 0 and day 7 that don't develop much pigmentation. You grow the fish in the presence of amperone, and it looks like you get some more melanin. We're now working with this in mouse to see if this translates to a mammalian model. So that's small molecules. Let's talk about ways that we might now identify other things that maybe may teach us something about the pathogenesis of albinism, but then also maybe give us some new druggable targets that we haven't thought about. So here, the central hypothesis of this work is that we would postulate that there is something that's similar between OCA1A cells and OCA2 cells. So two forms of albinism caused by two different mechanisms that's shared between those two, but is different than controls. Target here is going to be the retinal pigment epithelium. We're targeting that because those are the cells that are closest to the developing retina. The methodology that we'll use is differentiation of induced pluripotent stem cells to human RPE. So as I think pretty much everybody in the audience knows, you can reprogram many types of cells in the body. In this case, it was skin fibroblasts. You can do it with white blood cells and other cell types into basically de-differentiated cells, induced pluripotent stem cells that can then be differentiated using a protocol of some sort into your cell type of interest. In this case, retinal pigment epithelium. Here, my colleague, Dr. Kapil Bharti, using his knowledge of the developmental biology of retinal pigment epithelium, was able to develop a very robust method for differentiating these cells where the RPE that resulted, the human RPE that resulted from this technique, recapitulated all of the kind of characteristics that you would expect in a normal, healthy RPE cell. So it would, the morphology, the pigmentation, the cell markers, I didn't talk about this, but the retinal pigment epithelium phagocytosis, the outer segments of the photoreceptors, the electrophysiology of the cells, and also their gene developmental profiles. In fact, these cells are so much like our native RPE that he's currently using this in a phase one trial of RPE transplantation in patients with age-related macular degeneration. So here we took fibroblasts from two individuals with OCA1A or two and two from OCA2 plus controls, made iPSCs, did all of the relevant controls to show that they have normal karyotype and markers. And we used, importantly for this work, two clones of each. So all of the results that I'm going to talk about were replicated in all of the clones. At a gross level, you can see that here's normal pigmentation of control cells. Here's OCA1A cells, which essentially lack pigmentation. OCA2 cells make some melanin pigmentation, which is consonant with what we see in patients. So here we have, it's good when you're walking into an experiment to kind of think about, this is what I'm expecting to go in. So in patients with albinism, I would expect, based on the phenotype I see in patients, that the RPE would be mostly healthy, that the differences that we're talking about are going to be more subtle differences in cell biology or gene expression. They're not going to be a night and day difference. And the reason I say that, if there were things, for instance, with cell junctions that were abnormal, you would expect fluid to accumulate from the bloodstream into the retina. You don't see that. If the RPE were sick, you would expect the retina to degenerate, and you don't see that. They don't develop retinal degeneration disease. And so this is, in fact, what we see in our model. So as you might expect, again, at electron microscopy level, you see pigmented melanisms in OCA1A cells, and you see some pigmented melanisms in OCA2. This is quantitated here. Here's pigmented melanisms in control. It's essentially no pigmented melanisms, only premelanisms in OCA1 cells, and then same thing for OCA2. The overall melanosome density is significantly decreased, as you also might expect in OCA cells, OCA1A more than OCA2. And in the albinism cells where you were making melanosomes, you often saw melanosomes that had this abnormal morphology. We postulate that these are actually degenerating melanosomes. So a subtle phenotype that looks like it's reproducible in this model is a phenotype looking at the apical processes. So the side of the cell that's interdigitating, that is right intimately connected with the, or adjacent to, I should say, the outer segments of the photoreceptors, those apical processes. The first thing that we noticed was that a cell marker called Ezrin, which lives there, was qualitatively reduced in our OCA cells, OCA1A cells more than OCA2. Moreover, at least in the OCA1A cells, we saw by electron microscopy that the apical processes occasionally developed these balloon-like or blebbing of the apical processes. And so it leads us to postulate that there's something required, that there's some relationship between melanosomes, which I should also note, the melanosomes do something interesting. They move into and out of the apical processes. We don't know exactly why that happens, but that's the observed behavior. And maybe the absence of those melanosomes or of the melanin somehow affects the cell biology of the apical processes. And maybe because those processes are intimately opposed to the outer segments, maybe that is affecting our photoreceptor maturation, to be continued. So how are we going to go about obtaining molecular markers? Well, doing RNA-seq, RNA sequencing will give you is a hypothesis generating method for looking at the RNA transcriptional profiles of different cell populations. Here you again see the Venn diagram as I showed before. And in the dendrogram, you see that control cells, their profiles of RNA are more like one another than they are the OCA cells, and the OCA cells are more like themselves. When you do this kind of experiment, you get a lot of data, and making sense of it can be a challenge. But the kinds of things that you're looking for are big effects, effects that you see in all of your experimental samples compared to your control samples. And in our case, we are very interested in druggable targets. And so the one that I'm going to talk about, this is unpublished preliminary data, is insulin-like growth factor 2. So when we look at the levels of insulin-like growth factor 2 in our RPE cells using quantitative reverse transcriptase PCR, they're higher in control than in albinism cells. But IGF-1, which is a closely related molecule, is present in both, but approximately equal. What is insulin-like growth factor 2? So along with IGF-1, it's the main ligand for a type of receptor, type 1 IGF receptors, IGF-1R. These are tyrosine kinase receptors that once ligand binds, they dimerize, and then they go through various signal transduction mechanisms that we'll talk about. IGF-2 can also bind to the insulin receptor. And then there's this third type of receptor, which is not really a receptor in the way that we think about it, the type 2 IGF receptor, which binds to IGF-2, but appears to act kind of as a molecular sink. So it doesn't appear to be coupled to second messenger systems. In the CNS, there's been some data to suggest that this is involved in learning and memory in the hippocampus. IGF-2 is also, like IGF-1, is also bound to various binding proteins, which affect its pharmacodynamics in the body. IGF can signal via different mechanisms. And here, it's not completely understood, but depending on the cellular context, it can signal through the PI3K, AKT pathways, or the RAS signaling, a small GTPase protein signaling pathways. People have studied the role of IGF-2 in a variety of cellular functions or biologic functions, all of which could potentially be related to foveal development. These include angiogenesis. So the fovea I didn't mention is also avascular, which is important for having a substrate, a neural substrate that gives you 20/20 acuity. neuronal growth, the maintenance of neural stem cell niches, cellular differentiation, and cell proliferation. So if we look at where IGF-2 is expressed, so in control cells here, you're looking at an immunofluorescence measurement. You're looking down at a petri dish of cells. These are outlined using a marker called Z01. IGF-2 is in red. So IGF-2 is in control cells. And if you look at the orthogonal projections, you see it tends to localize here to the apical membrane, kind of where we would want it to be. In OCA1A cells, it appears that it is also present. It may be qualitatively reduced. We're not sure. You can't really tell by this technique. But it was intriguing to us that maybe the subcellular localization is not what it is in wild-type cells. This has to be confirmed and determined using other means. Now, you can also, with these cells, the apical side, the top side of the RPE cell is not the same as the basal side. And when you grow these cells, you can grow them in a system called transwells, where you can manipulate or measure things in either one of those cellular compartments. And so when we measure IGF-2 release by, in this case, it's an ELISA assay, we see, so this is a control line. And then here, this is, so these are actually different than the lines that I showed you. So this is actually a genetically engineered line where we deliberately knocked out tyrosinase. And then here is one where we gene corrected an OCA2 line up to control levels. And so you see that in the OCA lines, you see reduced secretion of IGF-2, at least preliminarily. So I will end up here by kind of concluding. So I hope to have shown you that small molecule therapies, they have some promise, at least for some types of albinism. In the case of nitisinone, we were able to improve fur and ocular pigmentation in our preclinical model of OCA1B. In our pilot studies of human, we did not get an ocular increase in melanin, but we did get at least a hint of a signal in some individuals peripherally. Purified tyrosinase can be used successfully to identify activators and inhibitors of the enzyme. And our current in vitro data and zebrafish data suggests that amperone may be a potential activator worth exploring more. Moreover, we've shown, I think, that IRPE models of OCA1A and OCA2 recapitulate some of the cellular phenotypes that we expect in albinism. We note a predominance in these cells of premelanisms and degenerating melanisms, which we don't see in wild type. The apical processes demonstrate some subtle abnormalities in both morphology and in marker immunofluorescence, Ezrin immunofluorescence. And that our preliminary RNA-seq data comparing albinism cells to control cells suggests IGF-2 is a druggable target. IGF-2 is made and secreted apically by these cells and is decreased in albinism cells that were kind of independently determined. Where are we taking this? Well, we would like to know, what does IGF-2 do to the process of retinal development? It's hard to study this in animal models. Mouse doesn't have a phobia, rodents don't have a phobia. There are some subtle differences in the relationship of rods, the photoreceptors that help us see in dim light versus cones, help us see in bright light and see color. And so if we knock out IGF-2 in retinal pigment epithelium, although we're not going to see a phobia phenotype, maybe we can change that, we can change that ratio back. We can make it abnormal by knocking it out in control mice. What does IGF-2, you can also create photoreceptor-like cells in retinal organoids, again, derived from stem cells, cultured a different way than what I've just shown. We add IGF-2 to that mix. Do we affect the process of photoreceptor maturation? There also may be a human correlate. So Dr. Doherty can tell you better than I that there are patients who have a disorder called Russell-Silver syndrome, which due to an imprinting defect have reduced levels of IGF-2. It's kind of the opposite of Beckwith-Wiedemann in a way, where it's an overgrowth syndrome. What is the ocular phenotype in these patients? We know that there's not anything overt, but one of the things that you'll discover in medicine is that you find sometimes what that you need to look in order to answer the question. You can't rely on just the fact that nobody has presented something like that in the literature. What is their foveal morphology? And then lastly, the holy grail would be to have a foveate animal model. And lucky for us, my friend and colleague, Jim Lauderdale in Augusta, Georgia, has just created an albino anal. So an anal is a lizard. Turns out these lizards have two fovea-like structures. And when you knock out tyrosinase in them, you knock out one of their foveas. So if we were to give back, so is IGF-2 lower in the lizard? If it is, if we give back IGF-2, can we at least partially rescue that foveal phenotype? With that, I would like to thank all of the people that have been collaborators and people working in my lab, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Dr. Brooks. Time for some questions. Let's see if the students have questions first.
All right,
hold on, Anthony. Yes. Yeah. Huh? Sorry.
I was kind of attempting to be Patrick names, maybe 1901.
Mm-hmm.
You showed that treatment of retinal treatments improve melanin pigmentation, skin, and also the eye.
Mm-hmm.
Does it kind of like correct the aberrance?
Yeah. So the short answer is that I don't know. We haven't done that. It's a very good experiment to do, but we don't know the answer to that. It's an excellent question.
Okay. Dr. Brooks, can you stand here?
Oh, sure. Sorry.
They can see you on the
camera. Oh, sorry about that. Mm-hmm. Well, so when I'm presenting it here, those are the data as presented. However, we recognize that this is still a model system. So I don't know for 100% sure that whether that is an artifact, whether that is happening in vivo or not. So an experiment that we're trying to do now is to look at other organisms. So basically to look in vivo to see whether there is evidence of this kind of a blebbing phenomenon, this kind of abnormal morphology that we see. The other way that would be very comforting to me, there are other people working in albinism, would be if those results were also confirmed by something else, by someone else.
First of all, full disclosure, regularly that some of my best friends.
Uh-huh.
But I think there's an issue here that I'm really curious to get your opinion on, and that is that this could be a therapy that actually does more harm than good. It's sort of a model similar to that.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, the central rewiring of from the genicula onward,
yep,
from a very early time that I was involved in showing that. As soon as the afferents arrive, everything gets reorganized manipulated. So the system that is receiving more light, the foveal, could actually be really misinterpreted by the central visual pathways. And so, because they're so reorganized.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, have you thought about that? In other words, what's happening centrally, which is really early visual, might actually not be able to keep up with what you repair correctly.
Yes. Yeah, and in fact, I would be very surprised if by a postnatal treatment, we were able to restore something too normal. Because so the kids with a complete form of albinism have 20 over 200 vision or 20 over 300 vision. So they're legally blind. If I were able to move the needle to get them to 20/80 or 20/100, if I were to get some kind of partial vision correction, to me, that would be a win in terms of their day-to-day existence, what their educational needs are, how much they need in terms of enlargement with texts, whether they opt, some of the patients opt to learn Braille, some don't. So here, the point is very well taken that it's probably unlikely, unless we were able to do a prenatal treatment, which is obviously much, much more complex, that we're going to be able to move the needle to completely normal. What I thought you were going to say, which is also a concern, at least for nitisinone treatment. So the reason we started with adults is safety, right? That I am a little, so the kids with hereditary tyrosinemia type 1 are intellectually impaired. And I'm not quite sure what the reason is that. Yeah. Yeah. They have the temperature sensitive right. mutation. Yeah, Siamese cats would be a great model. Yes.
So related to that, if I can ask, I was very interested to see the anal, lizard model, but I was thinking about birds, and particularly some of the predatory birds that are biphobia, like peregrine falcons that have these very high density phobia, very high altitude, that have some incredible acuity. And then right as they come into the kill, they switch to the other phobia as well. Being that they're closer to being warm-blooded thermoregulators, much closer to mammals, et cetera. I was wondering if that might be an interesting model.
That's a good suggestion.
I'm sorry, more questions. Yes.
Yeah, I had two questions. First, do you see any other labs utilize your IRP model for research? And then two, what is your future direction for the nitisinone studies?
Yeah, so taking the second question first. So we would like to now move down, cautiously move down the age chain. So here I would move to teenagers or older children. So people where almost all are, always hesitate to say all, because there probably is still some plasticity, say in an eight-year-old, not as much as a two-year-old or a one-year-old. But there's still probably some plasticity. Just in terms of the response of melanin, do we see a difference in younger people? So that would be one of the next steps clinically. Preclinically would also be to look at other forms of albinism. So we've looked at OCA3, which is due to mutations in TERP1, which is the enzyme that Kenny worked on. TERP1 is required to stabilize tyrosinase, and we were interested in knowing if we could make it work basically the opposite way. Could we stabilize TERP1 by making tyrosinase even more stable? Unfortunately, that didn't work. But other forms preclinically for albinism. Have other people use the IRPE model? No, there's other people that are working in Europe that are kind of working in parallel with us on this, but they're not using our cell lines. Like we're happy to give out our cell lines, but I'm not aware of anybody that's replicated the findings that we have. Kapil Bharti's lab is actually, so we are giving them to him. He has a staff scientist, so we didn't, it's a bit of a tangent, but kind of informally polling the folks in the United States who see a lot of patients with albinism. Nobody has seen an adult with albinism with age-related macular degeneration. which is central photoreceptor degeneration. We don't. So it leads to the question, you know, why might that be? Is that real? Why might that be? And so they're actually using the cell model, but for something different. That they have ways of stressing the cells that are reminiscent of age-related macular degeneration.
Sorry, go ahead. In the middle here, then I'll get to you. Yep.
Is the biomedical chemical pathway for why that is oxidated, and is that something you can exploit in combination with the development?
Yeah. Yeah, so I mean, we kind of joked about it in the trial of, with some of the patients. You want us to shave your head and see whether this makes it. We didn't have any takers on that. So the exact mechanism, I'm not sure. But basically, when you're plucking out as you're plucking out fur or plucking out hair, you're basically just stimulating the hair follicle to kind of remake itself. And so it almost resets the melanocytes in the hair follicle, as I understand it. Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know exactly how I would do that, and I would be a little bit worried. But so because the tissues of the eye don't, by and large, regenerate, that if we were to give some kind of a toxic insult, we may actually be causing more harm than potential good. But I guess we haven't explored that as an option in the preclinical models.
Okay, we'll do one more question and then we'll wrap up. Okay, yes.
Now, this extreme was, at this part, we designed an MDI frame, Dr. Alex Acharya, that's reported to have some melanin called and it increases in age. Do you think it is OCD? What do you think they are kind of like affected in the amount of melanin there? And what do you think might be the implication, knowing that this region is very important for the control of the.
Yeah, and I realized I didn't answer your question. So the short answer to your question was we actually haven't looked at neuromelanin. So the melanin in the substantia nigra is it's melanin, but it's neuromelanin. So it's not biochemically identical to the melanin that we have in our eyes and our skin. We don't know whether that increases when you increase tyrosinase. When you raise tyrosine levels in the plasma of individuals, you do in this case, it would affect the eye. It would be the case for the eye too, but tyrosine has to get transported into the brain. And it might be part of the reason, might be a difference between human and mouse, why we didn't see an effect in human, but we in the eye, but we may have seen something in the periphery.
Okay, please join me in thanking Dr. Brooks for the same.